really like to introduce you to the specialist we have tonight here, who contributed from the free time and to help this initiative to take place. So I would like to give the ground to our dear professors. Mr. Xanthopoulos, maybe you can start with presenting yourself.
Okay. I am a researcher in the Institute of Mediterranean Forest Ecosystems of the Hellenic Agricultural Organisation called Demeter in Greece. I am a forester with studies at the School of Forestry of the Aristotelian University of Thessaloniki and master's and PhD studies at the School of Forestry of the University of Montana in Missoula, Montana, USA. I specialized in forest fires, both my master's and PhD. And following that, I returned to Greece, where since 1990, I work from various posts in the field of forest fires. So it's the center of my research work. And I have participated in more than 30 research projects, either European funded, mostly European funded, but also some Greek ones. And I have a history of contribution to the forest fire issue, world science, if you want, in the European Union, but also internationally. I'm a member of the board of directors of the International Association of Wild and Fire. And I have always tried to connect theory with practice. That is, I'm trying to do applied research as much as possible. And I have had the opportunity to work close to the operational people, especially in the 1990s, when I was advisor to the General Secretary of Forests, then to the Minister of Public Order, then to the General Secretary of Civil Protection. And this has given me a good insight in of the operational world. It's very important if somebody can do that, because then he understands what are the real problems of practice compared to things that you do in the laboratory, which can be very interesting, but may be less of a priority to the people, to the operational people. And I have always tried to disseminate the knowledge that I have gathered through the years, and that's why I was happy to accept this invitation. So that's my profile.
Wow. Amazing. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr.
Very
Professor.
Very impressive. Thank you very much, indeed.
We are so looking forward to listen to your experience and your knowledge, of course. And I would like to introduce our specialist from the Faculty of Forestry of Brașov, and I will let Miss Camelia, to introduce herself.
Thank you, Bogdan. My name is Elena Camelia Mușat, as you know already. I am lecturer of the Faculty of Silviculture and Forest Engineering. I work as a lecturer of 4 years. In this autumn, I will make 4 years. In forest fires, I have these topics of 1 year as teacher, and I hope I will give some information, interesting information in my presentation. I also have, I am teach the topic of forest roads and ergonomics. And I make my PhD thesis at the Transylvania University of Brasov. The subject was the wood quality in trees located in the cities, in parks, and along the street. And I don't have such a big experience as the professor, but I am at the beginning of my road and I want to go on to work hard and to learn more things. Sorry for my English again. Thank you.
No worries.
Do you want to start?
Sorry, yes, sir.
Just a second, please. Let's inform the attendees that their questions, it will be better if they will write it in the chat room of the Zoom platform. And if there are any further questions after the time that will be given for the questions during the webinar, they're free to contact through the emails or for RLCs, or if the professors will be so kind to share their own emails to answer their questions.
And sorry for taking just 1 minute, maybe less than 1 minute. The IFSA members that they are right now in the webinar, they are also kindly asked to join the coffee hour that will happen tomorrow. More information on the IFSA Southern Europe Facebook page. So, Mr. Professor, you have the ground.
Okay, let me know if you can see my presentation, the first page of the presentation. Is it okay? Can you see it?
No.
We still see you, Mr. Professor.
You see me?
Yes, unfortunately.
Okay, we'll find out. Just a moment. We go with share screen. And then I am turning this on. What about now?
Still not happening.
We'll find out.
Simon, are you around?
Here is the presentation.
I'm around. I am. It works now.
Great.
Yeah, it works perfectly.
Okay. So I did choose to show you a presentation I made in a course last year in France, which is, I hope, interesting. We may have to cut it down a little bit because it's intended for a little bit longer time. First of all, I would like to tell you that we use the term forest fires in Europe to designate the unwanted fires burning forests and wildlands. And this is a serious problem, but the same roughly meaning comes from wildland, a wildfire in the United States. That is, they use a different term there. And in other places, there is different terms, like in Australia is a bushfire, and they have different names in different parts of the world, although there exists a sharp gradient from the south, that is the Mediterranean, to the north, in terms of fire regime, and it has to do with contributing and causing factors, fire frequency and burnt area, fire behavior. No country is exempt. That is, forest fires exist practically everywhere, but the situation is changing in the last few years as a result of various factors that we will discuss in a minute. Here is, you have a view of the forest fire statistics in the southern member states of the European Union. What you will see is that we have the number of fires picking up in the... Can you see my pointer?
Yes.
As I move it? Okay, good. You can see here that we have a peak of the number of fires in the late 2000s, in the early up to the middle of 2000s, and then the number is dropping. You can see that the burnt area has decreased a little bit in the last few years, but it's not disappearing, and it has a characteristic that there are some bad fire years, as you can see. You can see it here. Okay. And you can see that the average size of fires, after dropping strongly in the 90s, as the countries adopted more resources and more money spent to larger budgets to fight the fires. After that, after the 1996-97 era, more or less we have come to a plateau. That is, the number, the average fire size remains the same. You have to realize that statistics sometimes can be not very truthful. What I mean, in Greece, for example, in the until 1998, when the forest fire responsibility passed from the forest service to the fire service, we were reporting about 2,500 to 3,000 fires per year. In the next year, in 1998 and the following years, the fire service recorded fires in a different way, meaning that every fire that is not an urban fire, the urban fire service called it a forest fire. As a result, from reporting 2,500 or 3,000 fires per year, we moved to about 14,000 fires per year. It doesn't mean that the Greeks became crazy and started putting fires everywhere. It's just different statistics. What is the result of this? Even in very bad fire years, like in 2000, which was a very bad fire year for Greece, the average burnt area stays low because the denominator stays low, increases. If you increase the denominator, then the average fire size drops. So this is something that you have to be aware of regarding the value of the statistics that you see. And I like to show this slide because it is surprising to some people who do not have a view. They think fires are only widespread in the Mediterranean. And here you see a fire in 1975, the London Lunenburg Heath fire in Germany, which burned an area of 7,418 hectares, surprised the people in Germany, and five firemen died. And this was a major issue in Germany at that time. It never happened again in this scale, but in the last few years, we have had incidents again. Here you see in 2014, the Swedes, the people in Sweden, were surprised by this fire that burned 13,800 hectares and forced thousands to evacuate their homes, and they had one dead person. And the Italians and the French had to send commanders to help them fight the fire. And this was the largest fire in Sweden in more than 100 years. If you see here, it's Norway. It talks about the 3,000 acre fire, which means more or less not a huge fire, about 1,000 plus hectares. But what is important is that it took place in the winter time, in January, when you know that Norway is very cold. But it is possible, and it is surprising. Actually, they have fires in winter where they have a problem that the water is frozen, and they cannot carry water to the fire because it freezes in the tanks. In the fire trucks. They have different problems than what we can imagine. But even there, fires are an issue, and they are becoming more of an issue. And here we are talking about the UK, which has had in the last few years significant fires that sometimes have created issues even to homes, to villages, etc. So, main current issues about wildfires in the Mediterranean is that although the yearly burnt area is not increasing, damages are on the rise. This is a trend we are observing. That is, as you saw earlier, the burnt area is probably slightly decreasing. At the same time, we have a different pattern of fires. Fire behavior is worsening, and extreme fires occur somewhere in the Mediterranean every year. And with extreme fires, we have more damages. Fire suppression is becoming more challenging, and firefighter safety has become a major concern. Civilians are often threatened by wildfires, especially in the so-called wild-urban interface, areas which have become extensive in the last decades. I don't know if you have heard the term wild and urban interface. The term comes from the United States. It is a term that describes the growth of homes, of settlements within the forest. And there are different types of wild and urban interface. When these are combined with flammable homes, the situation can become easily a cause of disaster. The cost of forest fire management also is on the rise. That is, in all countries, the budgets are increasing regarding forest fires. So this means that the issue of forest fires is far from solved. In order to talk about solving it, we have to develop an understanding of the wildfire problem. So some key points. As I said earlier, the problem is worsening globally. Firefighting resources become stronger. Technology helps increase effectiveness. The yearly cost is rising, but the problem persists. A small number of intense fires is responsible for most of the burnt area and the damages. We have to understand why. High fire severities cause adverse ecological effects. That is, if we have a relatively mild fire, which can be a fire under non-extreme conditions with not extremely large fuel loads and so on, then the ecological effects of the fire can be less severe. The problem is when we put out the easy fires, then we only have extreme fires. And this is where the problem comes. We have damages and we have more severe fire effects, and we have larger budgets in an effort to try to control the situation. It is clear that we are doing something wrong. We need to understand the problem if we want to mitigate. And as Albert Einstein said, the significant problems we have today cannot be solved at the same level of thinking with which we created them. That is, we need to change our thinking. If you look at this, it's very interesting, especially this one here, because this shows about the trends in fire suppression cost and burnt area in the USA. And you have the blue line here showing that the area burning is increasing. And the number of fires is decreasing, which means that it's not a problem of a larger number of fires. They are doing everything to prevent the fires. So the number of fires is decreasing. However, in spite of the technologies, in spite of everything, the burnt area is increasing. At the same time, the suppression cost is increasing. And this is very important. Actually, in the United States, half of the budget of the Forest Service has ended up now in these last few years to be devoted to fire suppression, which means very little money is left in order to do forest management work, fire prevention work, etc., etc. In order to understand what's happening exactly, we have to look at the natural role of fire. Fire, strange as it may seem, is an essential element for the natural functioning of most forest ecosystems. That is, fire has a role in the function of the ecosystems. Now, how often fires occur in a type of forest ecosystem depends mainly on the rate of biomass accumulation, that is the difference between biomass production and its decomposition or removal, the probability of starting a fire by natural or anthropogenic causes, and third, the existence of weather conditions that will favor its spread. These three factors control how often fires occur in one type of forest ecosystem. Okay? So we can see things working like this, looking at the long-term balance of biomass. On one hand, we have biomass accumulation, we have growth, which adds live biomass. But also we have mortality in a forest stand, which adds dead biomass, age, natural competition, fire, insects, diseases, windfall and snowfall. All these create mortality and the dead material accumulates on the ground. However, this accumulation is fought, in a sense, by biomass depletion, the other side of the equation. First of all, we have natural gradual breakdown, which is a slow oxidation process. And insects, worms, fungi, bacteria, etc., work in this field, in breaking down the accumulated dead biomass. And there can be also physical biomass removal. This is where foresters can have a role when they manage the forest in a sustainable way. But also men in general, people in the villages, in the villages which are by the forest and so on, they can pick up wood to use it for their needs. That's what has been happening throughout history, especially using it for energy, to cook, to heat their homes, etc. And then we have animal grazing, which also plays a role. But when these two factors, that is the physical biomass removal and the natural gradual breakdown, are not fast enough and they cannot cope with the biomass accumulation, then nature has another solution, which is fire, where fire is a rapid oxidation, finishes off the circle and starts the growth from the start, from anew. Look at this. We have two opposite reactions. On one hand, we have photosynthesis. The plants take water from the soil, pick up carbon dioxide from the air, they use solar energy on the chloroplasts, and they create hydrocarbons and release oxygen. That's the process of photosynthesis. On the other hand, we have fire, which works exactly the opposite. It has hydrocarbons, takes up oxygen, in order, oxygen is necessary to have burning, and then creates, releases the CO2 that was initially put into the biomass, the, releases water, and the heat that is released during the fire is that solar energy that was captured in the cells of our plants in the process of photosynthesis. I hope this is quite clear. We know that as forestry students. So we have two opposing directions, and we have to understand this, and we have to also realize that when we do photosynthesis, we are capturing carbon dioxide, and this is something that is so obvious that, for example, the European Union created significant problems, projects like programs like the Forest Focus program in the late 90s and 2000s, which gave to the people incentives in order to plant forest vegetation in abandoned agricultural areas. Why did they do that? In order to capture, to sequester carbon dioxide, to reduce the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Unfortunately, when you don't take fire into consideration, you may be, as it happened in this case, creating problems. Why? Because you are developing a continuum and you are releasing only, you are capturing the carbon dioxide only temporarily, because fire will release it again sooner or later. In order to understand about the rate of breaking down of the material. I would like you to see this very nice graph, which shows an experiment in which the researchers took samples of soil of litter in the from the bottom of the, you know, dead needles and duff and so on, and they put it at various water contents into different temperatures and checked the rate of activity of the microorganisms in it, which break down this material, the dead material. And in, since they cannot focus and look how each microorganism works to break down the material, they measured the production of CO2, the daily production of CO2 from each of the samples, in order to evaluate this, the rate of this breakdown. And what you will see here is you will see that at 30 degrees, you have a very quick breakdown, very large activity. As the temperature drops at 20, at 10, the activity is decreased. You can see that. And if you look into your refrigerator, tell me what is the temperature in your refrigerator. In the normal compartment of the refrigerator is about 3, 4, sometimes maximum 5 degrees, which is less activity than you see here. That's why your food does not spoil quickly. But then if you go down to minus 18, then it's flat line, no activity at all. And that's what your freezer does. You see? So think about what is the situation in a country like Greece or another Mediterranean country regarding temperatures, because you will also see here the effect of water content, which is important. You have a combination. In order to have good activity, you want both the good temperature where they are comfortable to work, the microorganisms, and at the same time, you need some moisture. You want an example of that? I will tell you. If you go to the boulangerie, to the baker's office, a baker's shop, and buy three loaves of bread, and you bring them back home, and it's a warm summer day, and you leave one loaf of bread on your table, a second loaf of bread in a bag on your table, the first one just in the open, the second in a bag, and the third you put it in the refrigerator, think about for a moment which one will spoil first. It is tricky. Can somebody answer to this?
The one in the bag?
The one in the bag, inside the refrigerator or outside the refrigerator?
Outside the refrigerator, I'm thinking, but maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, okay. I agree, outside.
And what will be the second one to spoil?
The one inside. The one inside, but without the bag.
Inside we have in a bag.
Inside we have in a bag, and outside we have without the bag.
Yes.
Okay, so from my point of view, the one that is inside with the bag will spoil first. Mm-hmm. The one outside will spoil second, and the one in the refrigerator, we will eat it in the Christmas.
Okay. The one in outside on the table, which is not in the bag, will become like dry bread that you can preserve forever. And this is because you are in this zero in the graph that you see. It will lose all the moisture and the microorganisms will not work. The one in the refrigerator will take longer because it's less than the 10% you see there, but it will have the moisture and in a few days it will start smelling. And the one which is in the good temperature of 25 degrees or so on the table, but it is in the bag, so it doesn't dry out, That's the one that will spoil first. So you know the concept, you know it from your experience, and this is what will happen. Here we have the typical use of biomass in the past. In the forest, it used to be like this. It is the Greek forest, that is the people picking up wood. This was the traditional way of doing it. In Greece, we have not gone very much into the mechanized way of picking up wood, timber, because we are very careful with our forests, I would say. But of course, this does not give you the maximum value for your timber. You have to cut it in smaller pieces in order to carry it with mules. But also things like resin collection that we do in our pine forests, that also is a part of forest utilization. And it's important that these do not only act because they remove the dead material, it also acts because the people make profit, make a living out of the forest, and so they need to protect it. The other way, if you don't have the natural, let's say, the social way, the classic way of removing vegetation, is when you do biomass reduction through forest fuels treatment, which is something that modern forest management, forest fire management does. You see on the left a plot where we have removed the material on the left side, while the right side is the understory that we used to have before. So you can see the difference. This is in an experimental clearing we did on Mount Parmis in the 90s. And a few years later, a fire was stopped within these plots coincidentally. And the material that you produce can be can be turned into chips like this with a chipper. There are smaller and larger numbers, side chippers. And it can be like this on the side of the road. It's better if you remove it and just spread it up in the forest. You don't want to make big piles of this. And then another way is to do what you see here, which is called prescribed burning. That is, you can reduce fuel by burning so that you create patches of burnt areas. But we have to say that it's called prescribed burning because you write a prescription, you write a description of what are your objectives, what do you want to do it for, and how you will do it, under what conditions, with what fire intensities, and you can control all these through the way you ignite the fire and through the way you handle the overall situation. It's an art, and it's also it requires a lot of experience and a lot of ability to plan. It's not an easy and inexpensive process, but when done over large areas, the cost can drop. We said that fire is a natural factor in the Mediterranean ecosystems. Most vegetation species found in the Mediterranean ecosystems have developed survival strategies that ensure their perpetuation when fires occur at their natural frequency. So it's important to understand that we are talking about survival strategies, but the species, the forest species, can do it when the fires occur at their natural frequency. For example, what is the natural frequency of fires in the pine forest, Pinus halepensis or Pinus brutia forest in Greece? Maybe 50 to 70 years. That's when you expect more or less under natural conditions for these forests to burn. Maybe 100 years, but that's about it. Other vegetation like the so-called broad-leaved shrubs, it can have shorter intervals. As you see here, it says immediate resprouting of many forest species when their above ground part burns, burning their oversized part, such as Quercus coxifera, Pistacia lediscus, Arbutus cuneto, Erica arborea. All these species, when they burn, they resprout from the ground. And then other species like the pines that we have, they store seed in serotinous cones. Serotinous meaning that they do not release the seed immediately after they are produced, but they always keep a load of seeds in their crown. So in case of fire, they release large amounts of seeds in order to secure that they will regenerate. And some other species, like the cistus species, they store seeds in the ground, and when they find the opportunity to find light, they come up, they spring up, and within a short time, they cover the ground in order to protect the ground. And this is what's happening in the Mediterranean ecosystems. It may be quite different from what is happening in Romania. And we have to take this into consideration when we are talking about the various ecosystem types. For example, in Greece, if you start, and telling that to our Romanian colleagues, when we start from low elevation, we start with the typical Mediterranean vegetation, and we go higher up, and vegetation is gradually changing. And when we go to our mountains of 800 meters or 1,000 meters and above, we are turning into species which are not typically Mediterranean. For example, when we have true fir, which is Abies cephalonica in the south of Greece, Abies alba in the north of Greece, those are not species accustomed to fire. They do not have serotinous cones. So if the fire happens at the time that they do not have seeds in their cones, then regeneration is delayed by a long time. Sometimes it requires first a pine, like Pinus, like black pine, Pinus nigra, to come, develop a forest stand under which the true fir will gradually come in. So you realize that we have to understand very well the whole balance in order to be able to say how we will manage this. It's in general, pines are species which are coming in very quickly. They have light seeds and they can go over long distances, and they can also accept a lot of light. So they can be able to tolerate the light of an area that has the plenty of light and the dry conditions that are available in an area that has recently burned. Whereas other species require some shade, require some protection from the heat of the sun in the summer, or they, even if they start a small true fir seedling, it may die. Here you see what happens after the fire. This is just 4 days after the fire. As you can see, all these cones here, you can see that they are opened after the fire. It's not like these. They have, all this was opened after. That's why they are without any ash on them, ash deposition. And all the seeds, millions of seeds that were put out, the air, the wind, brought them in here in various places where it will be concentrated or it will be dispersed. And there, the rodents, the ants, the birds will eat. But there are so many millions or billions of seeds that they will find their way. And usually what happens is that if in the few months following the fire, first you will have the cistus coming in and the other species which are there with seeds in the ground in order to start developing with the first rains, to start growing. Within a few months, by the next spring, you will see a lot of reproduction from the shrubs which are evergreen and they are accustomed to fire and they resprout. And then a few years later, under the shade of the shrubs, you will see the pines starting to appear here and there and cover ground, and the new forest starts. So this is the situation under natural condition. You can see it here. This is in Ilia in Peloponnese after the fires of 2007, the huge fires that we had in Greece. You can see here how the Pinus halepensis has regenerated. Okay, that's only 2 years after the fire. You see how thick it is. If you don't go in there to thin it, thin this vegetation, it will become what the Americans call a dog hair stand. It is like the hair of a dog, very thick, and it will be ready for a new fire. So it's best if when they are small, you select for the best ones after the third year, for example, that at that time it's easy to cut the ones and allow the best, let's say, samples to grow and become large trees. And here on the right side, we have Pinus pinea, and we have regeneration here. This is, it has a thick overstory. The Pinus pinea is different from Pinus halepensis. And you see that there are no low branches. So the fire came in, just scorched the lower branches, did not burn the trees completely, but the heat made the pine open up the seeds and the cones and put out the seeds. And you can see here all the regeneration that has occurred. Here you can see 4 years after the fire, the situation regarding the evergreen shrubs that they are regrowing on the island of Samos. Okay? So you see what I mean by the evergreen shrubs, like Quercus coxifera, like Arbutus unedo, like Erica arborea, Erica verticillata, etc. And here you can see in an area in Pendeli Mountain, where we have a tough environment. This used to be tall forest in 1995, but we had fires in 1995, in 1998, two ice, it burned completely within 3 years. And then what happens in Pinus forests, if they burn before they go to an age where they can develop seed again, that is, it burns. It needs about 14 years before you have the young trees regenerate and come to an age where they produce enough seed for the next fire to be tolerable. So what happened here is we had a fire in 1995 and then another one in 1998, and part of it burned in 2000 and then in 2007 and then in 2009 the whole thing burned again. So there was no chance for pines to survive and produce seed. Even if there were some pines that had survived the first fire, they were burned in the second fire or in the third fire. And now you don't see any pines, except for where we are trying to reforest. But you see how difficult it is with this ground. Still, the shrubs, you can see here, this is resprouting. You can see the burnt shrub, and you can see the new vegetation coming in. However, if you burn even that, you burn it very often, the shrubs start dying out. They don't have time to pick up and store hydrocarbons in order to be ready for the next fire. So it cannot be tolerated too often. This is a situation that happens quite often when shepherds put fires in order to have fresh vegetation for their animals to eat. But after a number of burns, reburns, without times in between for vegetation to recover and produce soil and so on, the problem is that you end up with what we call desertification. Desertification, for your knowledge, does not mean we will see something like Africa, like Sahara. It means that we are losing the productive capacity of the soil. So, if fires are part of the natural circle of many forests, why do we want to suppress them? There are reasons, good reasons. First, ecological damage caused by the naturally high fire frequency, direct and indirect economic losses, loss of other forest benefits like aesthetic value, flood protection, the possibility of disasters in personal property and state infrastructure, potential negative health effects like smoke, and the sense of insecurity of the citizens, and often even the risk of loss of life. So you are seeing an example of what it means regarding smoke, but all the other things I think that you can understand. Most important, as I pointed out, is the ecological damage caused by the unnaturally high frequency, fire frequency. So you can see here, for example, in Attica, that we have in this period, 1984 to 2011, up to 6 fires burning in the same area, which means no chance of regeneration, which means probability, high probability of desertification trends. You can see here what happened when the, in 2007, the fires we had, it was the worst fire year in Greece with 80 dead people around the country. And in that year, the fires came even to the archaeological site of ancient Olympia. And you can see here how Cronius Hill used to be and how it became after the fire. And all these trees were basically dead. Probability of the landslide that would move this hill down into the Olympic Stadium immediately after that, the ancient Olympic Stadium. So my institute was asked to make a quick study of how we can save and avoid this situation. And we did that, and as there were no conditions, no, we had to do it quickly, and the next Olympic Games of Beijing would come, and in March, the fire happened in August 2007, in March 2008, we had to start to light the Olympic flame for the Beijing Olympics in China. And so we were asked to rehabilitate the site, to apply our study. And we did that with great success. We stabilized the soils with all these works that you can see here. And we introduced new, less flammable vegetation following what was there in the ancient times and so on after our study. However, it costed 2.7 million euros. So you understand, it is a major impact, cost impact. Because of the type of site that this is very important for the World Heritage, there were donors who gave the money, rich people. But that doesn't solve the problem of huge cost. And here you can see the problem of scaring the people. These are fires that we have had in Athens, in the suburbs of Athens. You don't want to be here. This is in the area of release here in Athens. And the people are running away from a fire that's coming on them. And this is something that scares people, and that's why they insist that they want the fires to be put out. And this is what happened in 2007 in Greece, when we had 80 people, as I said, and more than 3,000 people dead that year. It was a disastrous year. And then you will see what happened in Portugal in 2017 with 64 fatalities at Pedrogão Grande. And that same year, they had a second round in October. This is June. And they had another fire in October, a series of fires. Total 114 people dead in Portugal in 2017. And as the people were looking at this, what happened? What happened is that we are having fires in Greece in 2018, 102 people dead in Mati. And immediately after that, that was in July, and in October, they had 84 people in Paradise Fire in California, which is again Mediterranean environment. Mediterranean environment does not exist only around the Mediterranean. Mediterranean environment is characterized by a dry summer period of more than 2 months, and then a quite wet winter period with mild temperatures. And we have in the Mediterranean, we have in South Africa, we have in California, we have in Chile, we have in South Australia, like in Perth or in Victoria or in New South Wales there. And the conditions are the same. And if we go back to what I said earlier, we'll see that in these conditions, in the winter time, the temperature is not convenient for the breakdown of vegetation, but the humidity is fine. there is rain, there is water. In the summertime, we have the opposite. We have dry conditions, so the microorganisms cannot work. And at the same time, we have nice temperatures. As a result, most of the breakdown of vegetation or dead material will happen in the fall or in the spring. But if you look in the other side of the equation, the production is quite good. Maybe not in the direction of upgoing vegetation, like in the Scandinavian areas, where the plants are trying to find access to the sun, and they compete and they make long, tall trees. But it's practically possible to produce for the plants year round. They are not very afraid of, ice or freezing. Sometimes some places in Greece do not even have freezing, very rare. So that's why you have the evergreen shrubs, etc. And they are keeping their leaves on and mostly are concerned with keeping up moisture in the summer. That's why they have leaves which are, they have a thick layer of waxes to not allow all the water to evaporate. So in a sense, we have an environment where we expect that production is stronger than depletion, and that's why fire finds its role very quickly. It will happen in an ecosystem like the Arctic ecosystems. It will happen in Canada. It will happen in the in Germany or in Romania. The difference is that it will take much longer time. You have to realize that in our ecosystems, we have like 70 or 60 or 100 years of regular fire interval. But in an ecosystem like an Andes ecosystem, it could be 250 to 300 years, which means that more or less people do not remember that there was a previous fire, you see? And of course, if you are in a forest like in, let's say, Finland, where the people take up, they do good forestry, and they take up lots of produced material because it's one of their main sources of income, then of course you can help maintain the balance. But in the long term, even in those ecosystems, you may need fire. Sometimes you have to introduce fire. Why? Because if you have a very thick layer of, not like this, maybe like 30, 50 centimeters sometimes, of mosses and lichens and dead material, a seed from a tree that falls does not find where to start its roots. It needs to find the inorganic soil, and it will not find it. That's why in those ecosystems, it has to happen somehow. If you cannot have fire, it's an option that you scarify the soil. You create the openings where the seeds will fall, and they will be able to start the new circle of life. Even if you do good forest management and you remove the produced material every year or every 10 years, whatever is your circle of coming back to the stand. So the fires are becoming worse because we have changes in fuels, changes in climate and weather conditions, abandonment of rural areas, changes in the attitude of people, development of wild and urban interface areas, and because of failures in fire prevention. I hope I have given you a picture of why of the situation regarding forest fires. We have a problem that's getting worse. We need to be able to understand very much in depth, and we need to balance prevention with suppression. And in order to balance prevention and suppression, it is not better to give a lot of money for doing this clearing of forests and so on. What you saw earlier, that is as an example of cutting the understory, etc. It's best if we manage the forest. A well-managed forest, a forest with good silviculture that will keep the necessary balance, is the best option for fighting back fires. for keeping the issue better under control. Now, regarding some of the countries that we have seen, it has happened that many countries that thought had no problem, when they abandoned, when the people abandoned their land, abandoned their traditional use of wood, especially turning from using the wood, turning into other sources like electricity or gas, etc., that's when the problem started appearing. Or, of course, when the population moved away from the villages and went to the big cities. So, I think I should stop here because I have gone way beyond my time. Thank you very much.
It's very okay. It was a pleasure to listen to you, and we're very glad that you shared your expertise and insight about forest fires. The information, I believe it was more than valuable for everybody. And hopefully you will stick around also for the questions afterwards. And I think it's a good time to move on to Mrs. Mușat for her presentation. Bogdan, the ground for you too.
I want to ask the professor if he has the time to stick around. Or if not, if you want us to...
I do not have the time not. Because initially yes. I thought it was an hour earlier.
And it was a technical issue from our side, okay. And we want
so
to...
So we can take a few questions quickly for the next 10
minutes. Okay. Miss Professor, are you okay with us with just having a little bit of break to take the question for Mr. Professor and then to go to your presentation?
Yes, I only want to ask the professor why he chose to work with forest fires. Why?
I can tell
this,
you
this topic.
I can tell you because in Greece, in the School of Forest in Greece. The origins of the school were with German educated professors, Germany, Switzerland, and so on. And when I was a student in the late 1970s, we did not receive very good training on forest fires. Just a few lectures within the subject of forest protection. We call it Illyriki. The result is that I felt I was lacking the basic information on the first thing that as a young forester I would be asked to do when I would be in the field, because you need young people to be able to work and walk and do in the field. So that was in my mind that I did not feel I knew quite a lot. And then 1981, we had the first large wildland urban interface fire in the northern suburbs of Athens. And I was living in Thessaloniki at the time. I had been exactly finishing my studies, and I watched that fire from the building of the Greek television, which was in Agia Paraskevi in Athens. They could see the fire, and from the top of the building, they were reporting live, let's say. And they had people connected to this, and I was hearing so many stupidities that I realized that the country needed a lot of new knowledge on this. And that a specialist in insects, not in forest fires. He had just received one or two courses during his time, an organization that is responsible.
I can't hear you anymore. I don't know if
Did
he was probably disconnected for some reason. Hopefully he'll be able to get back to us soon.
Yes. Dear attendees, please, if you have any question, just go ahead. We saw the question of Shimon, and hopefully the professor will return to reply to that. And in the worst case scenario, we will send. I think that Marcia will take care of sending the email to the professor, and we will try to reply.
Have you heard me? What I said about how I ended up studying forest fire.
No.
Can you hear me?
The connection is somehow interrupted.
I gave a reply to your question, but I don't know if it was heard. Yes, I can see that.
We have heard a part of it, but at some point we stopped hearing you properly.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you clearly.
Mr. Professor, can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Great. Now we can hear you clearly.
Now we can hear you as well, yes.
Okay. Did you hear my response about how I started with forest fires?
Only halfway through, near the part that you were still in Thessaloniki, it was kind of interrupted.
Okay. Just to make it short, I realized that the country needed knowledge which it was lacking. And we had a problem for which not even the university was ready to reply. And I thought that we should look somewhere else for this information. I looked around, there wasn't very much available. And finally, I chose to go to the United States, exactly where the science was being developed, at the fire lab in Missoula, Montana. So I did my studies there with the best. And that was very helpful because I brought in a lot of information back to Europe. So throughout the 90s, I was able to transfer a lot of information firsthand to the European situation.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you for the answer.
Mr. Professor, we have one more question for you as far as from the chat. And the question is that I have heard the winter and spring fires have lower severity than summer ones. In theory, it will be possible to use them as prescribed ones and could be cheaper reparation. What is your opinion on such theory? This is from Shimon from Czech Republic, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes. Prescribed burning is something that we can use. It is being used globally, and there are various reasons for doing that. One is to reduce the production. Reason is to reduce the material that might burn, fuel reduction. Another one is to renew vegetation to produce fresh material for animal grazing, and that can be either domesticated animals or for wild animals. And there can be other treatments from clearing diseases to controlling competition. There are many uses. As I said, it has to have a good planning, to have objectives, and to be able to substantiate why you do it. And it can be cheaper sometimes than doing mechanical treatments. For example, It can be done after you remove, you do cutting, or especially clear cutting in many areas. In the United States, they do it because they want to remove vegetation, dead material on the ground. They want to remove the dead material on the ground so that the new stand is not being grown in a material, in an area which is full of dead material, because in case of a fire, it will be a very difficult fire to fight. So in order to do that, you can burn and remove some material. However, it took them some time before they found out that you do not want to remove all the material, not the large size logs, but the small size logs only and the small branches. The large size logs, you need to keep them on the side because they break down slower and they release materials little by little, and also they protect the soil on the site. So when you realize that, it means that the prescription you will do when to burn, the log should be wet in order not to burn out completely. When the fine material will burn, the log will go out, the fire will go out. So it will remain there. So all these are tricks. So we need to know why we do it, and we need to know the response of the vegetation to that. So without good study, we do not just go in and burn. I will have to leave you now. Thank you very much. And if you want to ask a few more questions, I will try, depending on the time, because I'm very pressed at the time, to reply. I have sent in the chat my email. And I will want to hear the Elena, but from a recording that you will do. You will send that to me.
Yes,
thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much,
Professor.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Bye. So, as the professor said, if you have any question, please check the chat. There you will have his email, and feel free to ask him any question. From what I can see, he's very open and he's very eager to share his knowledge and experience. And from my point of view, I think that we should give the floor for Ms. Professor, and to see what's the situation in Romania, how is going in Romania with the forest fires.
Okay, I will share the screen with you. It's okay, you can see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. I make a general presentation also with the forest from Romania and the species from the forest, and also with the situation of forest fires from 2 years, 2012 and 2017. So let's go. According to the Institute of Statistics, at the end of the 2017, the National Forest Fund occupy an area of 6,565,000 hectares, which represent almost 27% of the country surface. As you can see in this graph, for the period between 1990 and 2017, the surface of the forest increases a lot. Related to the state administrator, the form of the property, the states administrate a big part of this forest, almost 49%. Also, the forest can be administrated by the public property of the territorial administrative units and other individual or legal persons. According to the law 46/2008, namely Forestry Code in Romania, by forest, we can understand the land for the forest use, the forest protection cortines, the land on which the junipers are installed, and also the land covered with forest, pasture, or area of protection for hydrotechnical works and land improvements. Related to the distribution of the forest on the geographical region in the country, we can see that most of the forests are in the mountain area, almost 60%, and the rest of them are in the plain. A lot of species are hardwood species, almost 32%, because the Romania has a big biodiversity in the forest. We can have only pure spruce stand or only softwood stand, and also mixed stand. Related to the distribution of the forest of by age classes, at the level, at the national level, we can see that most of the forests are between 21 years and 80 years, almost 60% of all the forest. And if we analyze the data according to the forest administrated by the National Forest Administration, we can see that the over 60% of the forest are have ages lower than 60 years, as you can see here in this graph. According to the functional groups, you also know that the forests are can be grouped in two functional categories, with a protection function or with production and protection function. Most of the forest in Romania, almost 60%, 57%, is are included in the functional group one. That refer at the forest with special function of protection for water, soil, climate, and other objective of natural interest. In the second functional group, there are almost 43% of the surface of the national forest found, and include forests destined to the production as priority, and also of the protection of the land. The total standing volume of forests at the level of year 2017 is around 2,221 million cubic meters. And most of them of this volume is correspond to the beech species, because we have a lot of forests of beech or mixed of beech with spruce. Related to forest regeneration, you know that in order to achieve high quality stand and the continuous exercise by them of protection function, the forestry code provides, with some exception, the application of the high forest system and regarding the works of artificial regeneration and completion of natural regeneration, it is provided that they be executed within a maximum of 2 seasons of vegetation from the single or final felling. In 2017, forest regeneration works were carried out on the surface of 28,032 hectares, with a decrease compared to the previous year, a small decrease. The volume of wood harvested in 2017 was higher than in 2016. The volume harvested exclusively from the National Forest Fund was 70,344 cubic meters. And if you want to see the volume on the category of owners, you can see that most of this volume is extracted by the public property of the state, of the state forest, administrated by the Forest National Administration. In 2017, the timber was offered for sale on foot on as shaped wood in accordance with the previous provisions of the regulation of the capitalization of the timber from the public property forest funds. Starting with October 5 in the same year, the negotiation and the direct sale of the timber from the public property forest fund took place in accordance with the previous provisions of the regulation on the capitalization of the wood from the public property forest fund, accordingly approved by the government by a government decision. In 2019, from the state-owned forest managed by the National Forest Administration, wood was harvested in the total volume of 9,447,000 cubic meters, of which most of them are main products and less of them are hygiene products. From our forest, we can also extract non-wood products like forest seeds, berries, truffle, and mushroom, anti products, and even honey. Related to the protected natural area, at the national level, we have 30 major protected natural area, of which National Forest Administration manage 22 natural and national parks. Related to the forest roads, it's an important point for silviculture, because by forest road we can make all the works. We can have a rational management, but also we can arrive in an isolated point in the forest when we have to extinguish a fire, for example. At the beginning of 2017, the National Forest Administration had in administration a network of 26,430 kilometers of forest roads and 67 kilometers of forest railways. Related to the forest fires, as you can see in this graph, I make a graph for the number of fires produced in Romania during 1986 and 2017. And we see here that in 2012 was recorded the maximum number of fires, 911. This is why I choose to present you later the data for this year. Related to the burned area, the situation is almost the same. In 2012 was recorded that maximum surface for the burned area, which is almost double from that registered in 2002. According to the official data, most fires occur in November, December, March, and April, mainly to the practice of cleaning stump, dry vegetation, and plant debris using open fire. As I said, also professor, that is a technique also made in Romania. According to the legislation, during periods of heat and prolonged drought, the burning of shrub and dry vegetation is prohibited. On sloping land, the stubble is burned starting from the top of the slope. Burning of dry vegetation and plant debris is performed only after obtaining a fire permit, according to the provision of the general norms for the fire protection. Sorry. As you can see in this graph, I present you the number of fire produced in 2012, but these were distributed according to the data provided by Forest Guard at the national level. We can see that in Râmnicu Vâlcea was recorded most of the forest fires, and I can tell you that the largest number of the fires were recorded in the south and the southwest part of the country, and a lot of them affect the seedlings. Related to the area affected by the fires, the situation is almost the same. The Râmnicu Vâlcea was the biggest area affected by fires, and also Timișoara. Practically 35% of the area affected by fires at national level were registered in the forest under the jurisdiction of the Râmnicu Vâlcea forest fires, and 28% in the Timișoara forest guard. Related to the type of the fires, 86% of the fires produced in 2012 was litter fires, and 12 of them was canopy fires. The most affected by forest fires were the hardwood forest, which a number of 572 intervention. Compared to those, forest in the conifers forest are fewer, but still quite significant, because they represent 21% of the all fires produced in 2012. Compared with, if we take in consideration the geographic area, we can see that almost half of the fires were produced in the hills, and the other half was produced in the mountains and in the plain, and the approximately equal parts. Due to the certain factors, the duration of the fires was influenced by many factors that made the intervention more difficult, which led to an extension of the time from the outbreak of the fire to the time of the declaration of extinction, but most of them was extinguished in the same day when they broke out. Also, appear some cases where the fires were extinguish after an amount. I will present later some picture with a fire from 2012, which take place in Postovaru Mountains here in Brașov, and after the people can and the firemen can declare the fire extinguished, passed almost a month. The distance at which the fire occurs in relation to the forest rixes and the forest roads and water sources are also important, and we can we find out that the average distance between the fire and the forest district was almost 24 kilometers. Related to the forest route roads, the average distance was 2 kilometers, and in relation to the water sources, the distance between the forest place and the water source was almost 3 kilometers. In order to extinguish these fires, forestry personnel, firemen, gendarmes, policemen, and citizens who want to lend a helping hand were mobilized, totaling 31,450 persons in 2012. Most of them were citizens, almost 40%. After that, firemen and also forestry staff with 24% of the participants. At the level of year 2017, in Romania were produced 447 fires, which affected an area of 2,459 hectares, most of them in the national forest fronts, and a little part of them in land with located outside of the forest fronts. As a result of these fires, were estimated material damages totaling 618,000 lei, causated by the burning of a total of 207,000 seedling from plantation and natural regeneration, and a quantity of 267 cubic meter of raw material. In 2017, for the extinguish fires were organizing team, and these all people in number of now 9,470 peoples were also citizen, military, forestry staff, and policemen and gendarmes. If we analyze the causes of forest fires, we can see that a lot of them were unknown causes, and the most part of the fires were produced by negligence. Related to the nature of the affected property, 360 fires were produced in the state public property, 37 in the public property of administrative territorial units, and 160 fires in private properties. The most part of the fires were litter fires, and other part was were combined fires. The main cause of the forest fires is the spread of the fires from the agricultural lands to forest by pastures, for cleaning pastures, mainly before entering the vegetation on sunny days and without precipitation. These burns are either unsupervised or out of control due to local spring intensification specific to the spring period. And also burning of stubble after harvesting agricultural product during July to August. The calendar variations of the manifestation of the peak of fire production are given by the amount of precipitation, air temperature and wind speed, so that between 3 March and 3 April, 2,091 forests were recorded on 1,630 hectares. In 2017, no forest fires were highlighted, which would cause special problem from extinction. The main damage caused by the fires is found in plantation, especially in the conifer ones, because the low height of the seedlings favors the easy burning of their canopy, so that most of the time the respective plantation
There's probably some small connection problem. Let's wait a little bit to see how this will proceed.
Okay. In the meantime, as we can see, we have a question, and I will. I will really like, and I can bet that my colleague Marcia will like also everybody to, and or as much as possible, people to, if you have questions, just go ahead, share them with us in the chat.
As you can see, the situations described in the two presentations we had are quite different, and it will be only a benefit to hear your questions or even you to share your opinions. Maybe we still have people from countries that suffer a significant number of fires that would like to say something.
Bogdan, do you have information with the situation of Professor?
I have tried to call, but for some reason, from what I remember, she told me that she had to use the hotspot to connect with us. So from what I know, also, if you have a phone call, this hotspot is it's decreasing the quality of the internet provided. So I don't know. I will try to contact her.
Maybe also the attendees could be a little bit patient. The connections can be compromised at any time. So we would really like to have your patience for a little while more.
I really hope that the situation will not last for too long. So if I'm thinking that also it's evening, it's late, we will wait another maximum 5 minutes to see if the professor can return the conversation. And in that case, if she will not be able to return, we will try to find a way to I don't know, maybe some questions, like, for example, Shimon's question. I will make sure that the professor will receive it. And maybe we'll find a way to share with you the rest of the the rest of the presentation without having you to join another or having us to create another webinar. Maybe you can share with us what's your opinion about the webinar so far, because, for example, for us, for our LCs, is the first one, and we are also under the effect of emotions, and we would really like to get a feedback from each of you. Ah, we have the professor back.
Sorry, can you see me now?
Yes, we can see you now.
My internet is not very, very good.
There's no problem. Like, it's good that we still have our people engaged with us. And when you're ready, you can go on with the presentation.
Okay. I have to share it with you again, no?
Yes, that will be very, very helpful.
Okay. Okay, can you see the presentation now?
Yes, we can see it.
We can hear you.
The prevention of the and the extinguish measures are assured by the Ministry of Agriculture and by the Ministry of Administration and Interior by their structures, Rom Silva and Forest Inspectorate, and also by the Emergency Situation Inspectorate and country and local responsible authorities. A collaboration protocol is also established between this structure at both national and at country level. The actions of prevention and extinguish of forest fires are carried out in accordance with the legislation regarding the management of emergency situation as a result of forest fires. The monitoring of emergency situations, the evaluation of the information, then notification, then the warning, the pre-alarm and the alert of national level, as well as the coordination of the unitary application of the measures for prevention and management of emergency situation are provided by the Operational Center of Emergency Situation, constituted within the center authority responsible for forestry. Forest owners are obligated to take measures to prevent and extinguish fire and to equip themselves with specific technical means for preventing and extinguish fires. Measure to limit, eliminate or counteract forest fires are an obligation for central and local public administration bodies with responsibilities in this field and for all individuals and legal entities except the disabled, the elderly, children and other disadvantaged group. The natural or legal persons who identify a fire, forest fire, have to have the obligation to notify in the shortest time the fire units at the emergency number 112 and to participate in the fire prevention and extinguish actions. Person involved in the extinguish a forest fire must be equipped with chainsaw, axes, hose, spades, ropes than they use to prevent the spread of fire. Sometimes there are off-road vehicles owned by the forest district, trucks for the emergency situation, or even helicopters with tanks for water. The alarm plan of forces and means of action is made for organize all the works during the forest fires between the when the forest was announced and until all the people interested can find out the information and can find out what they have to do. The Forest Fire Protection Plan is the document that includes the measures, action, and resources needed to manage emergencies such as forest fire monitoring. The aim of this plan are to ensure the knowledge by all the factors involved of the tax and attribution incumbent on them before, during, and after the occurrence of an emergency situation as a result of forest fires to establish unitary and coherent framework of action to prevent and manage emergency as a result of forest fires. Emergency management as a result of forest fires means the identification and monitoring, notification of factor of interest, warming of the population, assessment, limitation, removal or contracting of forest fires. The objective of the plan are the following: ensuring the prevention of emergency situation as a result of forest fires by avoiding them their manifestation, reducing the frequency of production or limiting their consequences. Limiting, removing or counteracting forest fires. 3. Establishing the concept of intervention and the mode of action. And 4. Allocation and organization of forest and means necessary for the prevention and management of forest fires. Organizing the intervention and extinguish forest fires within the forest districts has as first step alarming the population. It will be carried out only for the inhabitants on the component locality or town in which the forest fire broke out. Alarming through the locality will be done only if more than 50% of the forested area of the locality is affected affected or is estimated to be affected. The alarm will be sounded by church bells and electric sirens. Forest workers who intervene in the events of a fire can call directly on their mobile phone at work. The step two is the evacuation of endangered population, animals or properties. The action of evacuation of the endangered population, animals or goods will be carried out when forest fires endanger immensely and extend to farm or household. The evacuation is ordered by the mayor of the city or town at the proposal of the local committee for emergency situation, and it is carried out with the support of the Minister of Affairs and Interior. The evacuation is carried out in accordance with the provision of the emergency evacuation plan. The people that have to work and to fight with the fires at the forestry staff, the voluntaries for the emergency services and the forest department for the emergency situations. And the last step is the intervention of at of litter fires. For example, the litter fires will be beaten with brooms, wheelchair paddles, shovel, and earth of sand will be thrown on the advancing fires. It will act with sprinklers and water sprays and will intervene to form a dam by mineralizing the soil and trying to ignite against fire if possible. The dam made by removing the incombustible material stops the advantage of the main fire. And if we have a canopy fire, we have also a protocol. The protocol can be specific for each forest district. For example, on length transversal to the direction of advance at a sufficient distance to that the fire does not catch the intervention forces in full action, the shafts are urgently lowered at a distance of 2 until 4 with the corridors parallel to the direction of fire. Horses or tractors remove fallow tree outside the forest hazard areas and dry areas. With the plows with horses or tractors, a strip of 2 to 3 meters wide is shown in the middle of the street formed by the removing the tree and the application against fires is tried. The intervention forces, with the help of paddles and showers, follow and stop the spread of the fire to the leaves and vine lit and carried by the drafts. Here I have some picture from the fire that take place in 2012 in the Postovaru Mountains that affect an area of 22 hectares. The characteristic of the land was that the slope was very high, between 35 and 60, 50 degrees. The altitude was also high, and you have some picture here. I don't know if you can see very good the pictures. This is the view from the top of the mountains. Also here we can you can see some picture from a fire that take place in in Vâlcea was a litter fire, so the affected surface was 24 hectares. The stand was composed by sessile oak, beech, and other hardwood species. The age varies between 40 and 150 years. These are some pictures with another fire from this spring that is also litter fires. You can see here how the fire spreads. And finally, we have another fire from the from this year, from the April, very near to the Brașov, in arboret, in the stand with Pinus special, Pinus silvestris. Thank you for your attention. If you have questions.
Thank you very much, Ms. Professor. It was very interesting from my point of view. I saw some new stuff, even though I'm Romanian and I've studied it in Romania. There was some new stuff that I saw, and I hope that the people could also see and hear something new.
Thank you. Sorry for my English.
I think that everybody was okay with that. Like, I don't think that it's it was a major.
I believe you were fully understandable. I think it's a good time to proceed to the questions, if you're also ready for that. And the first question comes from Shimon, again from Czech Republic. And he's mentioning that in the graph of fire numbers throughout the years, it seemed there was quite a difference before and after 2000. Has any significant management change occurred since that year, or what is the reason?
Just a moment, please. I want to...
Please take your time.
I can see the chat.
The chat should be somewhere in the middle. I don't know how is.
If you will move the mouse towards the bottom of your screen, probably a small line will pop.
Okay. Now I see only the question from Stefania. If you can repeat the question from
it's a little
Czech
bit
Republic.
Above.
It's a little bit just, above.
I can see it.
I will copy and paste it for you in this.
Hello,
case.
Or I can say it maybe.
Yeah, that would be maybe.
Good afternoon. Thank you for your presentation. It was interesting. Just around slide 20, I'm not sure, there was a graph of forest fires, number of forest fires each year. And it seemed to me that there was a difference after 2000 and before 2000. So there was, what was the reason? Is there any significant management change or?
No. Are not different in the management of the forest. Maybe the weather condition was a little bit different because we have more period without rain, a long period without rain. But also we can explain that by the data because after 2000 the data was centralized, and we know more about forest fires, and that's one point of view. And also we have the a lot of data, but when the firemen when they are not announced by calling at 112, they don't participate to the extinguish fires. The fire is extinguished only by the forest staff and the citizen. And this forest fire is not reported and registered. And maybe this is another reason for the difference.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The next question comes from Stefania from Romania. And she's asking, are there many situations of forest fires started on purpose with ill intent?
I don't think so. A lot of fires are started from negligence of the people, for the open fire, for the people from the rural area who start a fire for burning the dry grass, and the fire get out of the control. They can't control the fire, and the fire spread also in the forest and affect more surface. But the idea is not to have forest fire to the idea is to clean the dry wood for the animals in the spring. So no ill intent.
Very well. And it seems like we have another question from Maria from Greece. She's asking, when was the forest fire protection plan enforced?
I don't know exactly what means enforced.
When it has entered when it was maybe put it in the legislation, or when it has started to work in Romania.
National planning, maybe.
Mention for the forest fire protection are in legislation for many times. Also, the Forest National Administration have a plan to respect and some measure to take from the inside the district, and also to the directorate. The specification for the forest protection is also made in the Codul Silvic, forestry code, the law for the forestry in Romania from 2008.
Maria, if you think your question hasn't been answered and you're still here, feel free to take the lead and rephrase your question. If not, maybe we can go on with the questions.
Since I don't see a question, I would like to ask the professor on my own a question. We have from Maria the question. So, Marcia, go on.
No. She said that the question was answered.
Okay, I didn't manage to read. So, I have a question because everybody's talking about climate change. Is Romania right now, or this side of Eastern Europe, is it affected, and does the effect of the climate change is going to the extent of the forest fires, like increasing the risks of forest fires?
Maybe yes and maybe not. I think no, because the climate change is gradual, and the period with dry summers and the years with many precipitation alternate. I don't think that the forest fires will be very, very much influenced by the weather in Romania. Maybe in the plain of the Romania, in the dry part of the Romania, not in the south, not in the center and in the mountains. No.
I see. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are there any questions? Please feel free.
I have a question, if that's okay.
Yes.
So from the areas, the counties that you used to show from your graphs, please correct me if I'm mistaken. There's also some latitude pattern, some latitude trend about the fires, like areas like Suceava, for example, which are in the north, don't suffer that much from forest fires. And while we go to central in Brașov, in such areas, and then we go into Nicu-Vâlcea, the fires are kind of increasing. Have you indeed noticed such a pattern about the forest fires?
Yes, the most of the forest in the period that I analyzed it was in the south and the southwest of the country, most of them. And was quite curious because in the 2012, more fires were occurred in the hardwood species, not resinous. Maybe is because of the cause of the fires, not the species influence, but the cause of producing fires.
Great, thank you very much. And I have another small question, if you have the time for it. Do you have any training programs for civilians to participate in fire extinction? Like something like volunteering programs to train people to be ready for such cases?
No, unfortunately, no. I go with my students for the master at the firemen to explain them the equipment and the trucks they are using on the forest fire. They speak with us and say that we can participate if we want to a forest fire, but we don't always find out in the moment. We have find out somewhere after the fire.
Sorry, thank you very much for your answers.
Thank you also.
And I think that I will have a small question, and if there is no other question afterwards, maybe it will be a good idea because it's also a little bit too late. And we are so sorry again, also for the attendees and also for the professors, for the small mistake made by us. And we will try not to extend this period. So the professor, Mr. Xanthopoulos, if I'm correct in my pronunciation,
it's just fine.
Great. He said something about the silviculture, the level of silviculture of the northern countries, that they are taking the most of their forests. Now there is a problem, like a conflict, because, for example, in Romania, from what I remember, about 60% of the public forests, they have this PEFC and IFSA certificate,
yes,
which they ask for the debris, for a percentage of the debris to be let in the forest. So isn't it a little bit of a conflict? What shall we do? Because I remember that also during the communist times and also before Romania, the integration of Romania in European Union, the forests, the foresters and the forest services they were taking more care of everything as much as possible, things to be taken out from the forest. Now we have this trend to kind of let the things in the forest for the biodiversity reasons.
Yes, the biodiversity is important, but right now the wood with small dimension is in the forest. It's not economically to take the small wood from the forest only if you have a pellet station of something for valorificate with chips the small wood. The most part of the small wood after the harvesting the remain on the field.
I see. Thank you very much. So, is there any question?
Let's chance people TikTok.
By the way, Ms. Professor, may I share with the people in the chat your email address
if they want to
place you any question? Okay, I will do so just right now. Okay. Okay, so from what I, okay, just a second.